Hello there, my humble black smiters, and welcome to a new mini-series covering the Primarch you voted for in my previous Primarch video. And that Primarch, while also being my personal overall favorite, is none other than Mighty Vulcan. In this episode, as you are surely used to by now, we will cover his early years, rise to power on his homeworld of Nocturne, some trials he faced before being reunited with the Emperor, and finally, his late integration with the Legion. I am your host, the Grimdark Narrator, and without further ado, let us learn a few things about Vulcan, shall we? When the Primarchs were first created beneath the Himalayan mountains on Terra, through the machinations of the Chaos Gods, their capsules were scattered across the galaxy. The Promethean Opus, a saga and main source of Imperial knowledge on Vulcan, tells the tale of how one of these children ended up on the feudal death world of Nocturne, during one of its most tumultuous periods known as the Time of Trials. Among the hardy and stoic people of Nocturne, the infant Vulcan had fallen like a blazing comet, and into the home of a blacksmiter, a metal worker by the name of Nebel. This guy took Vulcan as a foster son in the city settlement of Hesiod. Nebel, recognizing the child as the one prophesied to be a savior by the teachings of the Promethean cult, named him Vulcan. Like all the Primarchs, Vulcan grew very quickly, reaching full adulthood and a size bigger and more muscular than any man of Nocturne by the age of only 4 Terran standard. He was also highly intelligent, able to vastly improve the already formidable metalworking skills of the famed smiths of Nocturne. Quickly, he had risen in strength and wisdom, embracing the culture which had taken him up, working in his adopted father's forge, and hunting the great saurians and other creatures bestirred by the planet's fiery temper. He also became a legendary champion in his world's defense against its most dangerous foes, Duskwraiths, as they were known on Nocturne. In reality, these creatures were of the most degenerate and vile class of Eldar slavers, aka Dark Eldar, nightmarish beings to whom pain and slaughter were as meat and drink. These cruel assholes had been periodically preying on the hardy people of Nocturne for a very long time. The Promethean Opus tells that during Vulcan's 4th year, the town was attacked by the Dark Eldar, who were on a usual slave-taking expedition. The people of his town hid away, as they usually did when the Dark Eldar came raiding, but Vulcan refused to do this. Armed only with a pair of blacksmith hammers, he roused the people from hiding and drove back the assault, single-handedly killing 100 of the Dark Eldar. As word of the battle spread, the headsmen of the 7 most important settlements of the planet came to pay homage to Vulcan, swearing to forevermore crush their foes rather than hide from them. Against this threat, Vulcan became transformed, and his legend spread across the whole world. He was the Fireborn, an undefeated warrior whose superhuman might had torn the slave barges down from the sky and crushed the evil Xenos in droves. In celebration of the Primarch's victory over the Dark Eldar, a tournament of various contests involving tests of strength and craftsmanship common to the people of Nocturne was held. During the open ceremony, a stranger appeared. His skin was unusually pale, compared to the dark, swarthy complexion of the people of Nocturne, and his clothes were very strange too, made of materials unfamiliar to the pre-industrial Nocturnians. The stranger asked only that he was allowed to compete. He claimed that he could best any man at any competition, causing many people to laugh at a seemingly inadvertent comparison to the superhuman Vulcan. Vulcan, though, accepted the challenge, and the stranger wagered that whoever lost the challenge would swear his eternal loyalty and obedience to the victor. With a polite smile at such effrontery, Vulcan agreed to the terms. Lasting for 8 Nocturnian days, this contest included many tests of strength and endurance. The people of Nocturne were treated to the spectacle of two godlike beings competing against one another, utterly astonishing the mere mortals around them with their superhuman prowess. Many of the contests had to be called a draw between Vulcan and the fair-skinned stranger, for there was simply no way to determine a victor. For example, the anvil lift, where the contestants were required to hold an anvil aloft above their heads for as long as possible, ended in a tie, when the two superhuman competitors both held anvils aloft for half a day with no sign of tiring. All the subsequent contests saw similar outcomes, and by the end of day 8, Vulcan and the stranger were tied in the overall tournament. To break the tie, the elders of Nocturne decided that the winner would be determined by the test of salamander hunting. Both contestants were given 24 hours to forge a weapon before using that weapon to hunt down and slay one of Nocturne's reptilian salamanders. Assessing that this task, impossible for any others, would be a formality for both godlike contestants, the elders included a caveat that the contestant who brought back the largest salamander would be proclaimed victorious. Vulcan and the stranger worked all day at their forge, neither pausing to rest. As the day drew to a close, they emerged. Vulcan had created a huge warhammer, and the stranger a keen-edged sword. They both climbed to the summit of Mount Deathfire. This was a massive volcano said to be home to the largest of the fire drakes, which were themselves the most fearsome species of salamander. Vulcan found his prey first, smashing its head off with a single blow from his hammer. As he was carrying the carcass back, the volcano unexpectedly erupted. Vulcan was almost thrown off a cliff, but did manage to grab onto one edge with a hand, stubbornly grasping the tail of his prize with the other. Vulcan held on for several hours, but his hold finally began to slip. It was at that fortuitous time that the stranger reappeared, carrying a salamander even larger than his own. The stranger quickly threw the carcass into the lava flow, using its heat-resistant hide as a bridge to cross over and save Vulcan. In turn, Vulcan was declared the winner when he returned home, since he had a salamander hide and the stranger had nothing. Vulcan, however, silenced the gathering crowd. He knelt before the stranger, stating that any man who valued life over pride was worthy of his service. At that moment, the stranger finally revealed himself to the Primarch, in his true form, as the Emperor of Mankind. Vulcan would take his place as the rightful Primarch of the 18th Legion, and ruler of his adopted world. Vulcan's only reservation on departing Nocturne was that he would leave his people undefended. But in this, the Emperor countered that Vulcan's duty was not simply to one world, but many. These were worlds that knew the terror of darkness and the feasting of alien horrors uncounted, just as Nocturne had, and that Nocturne itself, as the homeworld of a Primarch, would forever be secured by his sons, the warriors of the 18th. It is believed that Vulcan didn't become unified with his own legion for some years after his rediscovery, but instead stayed alongside the Emperor under his direct tutelage, during which time his presence was kept from the wider Imperium. During this period, Vulcan pursued with frightening speed and comprehension learning in the arts of war, history and science, displaying a ferocious intelligence, but also wisdom and rare compassion. Those traits were perhaps at odds with the role he was destined to play, as a general and breaker of worlds, as all Primarchs were made to be. He fought at the side of the Emperor in battle. A colossal, nameless warrior in emerald armor, scaled like a dragon of ancient Terran myth, and studied closely in the weapon forges of Mars with his brother Ferus Manus, whose discovery had gone before his own. Finally, the time came, as much dictated by circumstance as by choice, for Vulcan to take charge of the 18th Legion and set about reforging them on the anvil of war. When Vulcan came to his legion, it was in their hour of need. The 18th, led by their Lord Commander Cassian Vaughn, had become embroiled in the rearguard defense of a cluster of colony worlds near the Taras Division against a wave of Orc Marauders. With the bulk of the Legiones Astartes either engaged with the expedition fleets breaching space towards the Eastern Fringe, or committed as reserves against the horrors of the Rangda incursion from the Halo Stars to the Galactic North, the 18th was the only force able to respond to this crisis. Fighting against vast and overwhelming odds, the Legion's main force, numbering some 19,000 Space Marines, had marshaled the local defenders and held out for almost a year. This was done in a series of running battles against more than 1 million Orc raiders scattered across hundreds of ramshackle ships, rock asteroid vessels, and multiple space hulks. The actions of the Legion had allowed the evacuation of 3 planetary populations to the nominal safety of the Taras system, but at a terrible cost. As the conflict progressed, they suffered the grievous wounding of their commander, while the remainder of the 18th became all but trapped on the dead world of Antaeum. This world became a lightning rod drawing the Orcs to them for battle. Taras was far from the embattled frontier of the expanding Great Crusade, and assistance from other legions would have been difficult to obtain. But regardless, such aid was not even asked, because the 18th was determined to succeed alone or die in the attempt. Their Primarch, however, learning of their plight, refused to stand by and brought his plans to join them to rapid fruition. When Vulcan arrived, he didn't do so alone, for he brought with him 3,000 new initiates, the first of the Legion to be raised from Nocturne, along with a host of new warships, war machines and arms, all fabricated to the Primarch's own exacting specifications. They fell upon the Orc Marauders like a thunderbolt, and shattered the largest of the space hulks orbiting Antaeum. Spurred on by this unexpected aid, the rest of the 18th hurled themselves in renewed fury at the Orcs besieging them, slaughtering and scattering the greenskins before them, heedless of their depleted munitions and manpower. Caught between the hammer and the anvil of savagery that overmatched even their own, the Orc horde was broken and put to flight, and the survivors were relentlessly pursued and consumed by fire. In the aftermath, the two halves of the Legion met and were unified upon Antaeum's dead coral plains. As their saviors removed their helms and the Terran legionaries looked upon the faces of their brothers and he that was their gene father, they couldn't help but know that they were one and their Primarch had come to claim them. The survivors of the Terran 18th knelt immediately before their Primarch, but Vulcan told them to rise, saying that all his sons were equal and that he was not a petty king needing shows of obedience. Instead, it was he who knelt, in honor of the lives they had saved and the price they had paid. Then, seeking out the mortally wounded Lord Commander Vaughn, he conferred the formal transfer of the Legion's mastery. After the battle at Antaeum, Vulcan set about remaking and reforging the Legion, keen to keep the honor, the spirit of self-sacrifice for the Imperium, and bravery he found, but also determined that it should stand together and become more disciplined both in its temper and wiser in its pursuit of battle. With his forces brought together, Vulcan returned the 18th Legion to Nocturne. Here, under his auspices, a powerful stronghold, equal to any Legion fortress in the Imperium, was being constructed on Nocturne's moon of Prometheus, to serve as its headquarters and armory, just as Nocturne itself would be the source of the majority of the Legion's fresh recruits. Here, the Legion was reordered and rearmed, and most importantly, Vulcan set about giving it a common purpose and common belief. In order to do this, he drew not only on that which he had learned at the side of the Emperor and from the Imperial War Machine, but also on the culture and deeply ingrained warrior and mystical traditions of Nocturne, in which Vulcan had been raised. In this, Vulcan was wise enough to retain the value and experience of the Terran veterans and show them respect and hold in high esteem what they had accomplished in many ways, great and small. This was given outward sign by incorporating the 18th Legion's past heraldry into that of the reformed Legion, and making their foremost warriors his own pyre guard. For the fallen first master of the 18th, Cassian Vaughn, Vulcan fashioned with his own hands a very unique dreadnought sarcophagus, called the Iron Dragon, so that Vaughn could serve as castellan and protector of Prometheus and the future of the Legion. The remade 18th Legion would now take the name from the greatest of Nocturne's Saurian predators, ancient and deadly creatures whose blood was fire and whose hides were as hard as emerald steel, the Salamanders of Nocturne. In this, Vulcan's choice carried a layered meaning, for not only were Nocturnian Salamanders monsters of savage power with a great totemic significance to the native people, but, as creatures, they showed unflinching loyalty to their own blood and offspring, and they were never more ferocious than in their defense. It was from the bleached white skull of one such great beast, known as Cassare, that adorned the shoulder guard of their Primarch's armor, that the Legion would now take its new emblem. When the Salamander's Legion re-emerged and departed Nocturne a few years later, it quickly took up a place at the forefront of the Great Crusade, smashing alien empires and bringing Lost Worlds into compliance as part of the Imperium. Although it would never reach the high numbers of legionary strength the likes of the Dark Angels or Iron Warriors possessed, its power and battle prowess were undeniable, and its conduct in war was regarded as exemplary. It had been tempered and proven, retaining the fearlessness and savage spirit for which Vulcan had been renowned, but those traits were now governed and kept in check by stoicism, lack of hubris, and considered surety of action. Vulcan brought his legion focus, purpose, and wisdom. It was now said of the Salamanders that they were neither quick to anger, nor prone to rush in blindly to battle as they had once been. But once they had decided to unleash their wrath, it was as unstoppable and terrifying as volcanic fury. Vulcan was able to save his genetic legacy because in them he saw great potential. The Emperor knew that Vulcan was the perfect son to temper the 18th Legion and forge it strong again. Learning discipline and patience, the Salamanders also learned that there is no better time to reflect than when they struck their oaths of moment and branded them into flesh before battle. Temperance in the face of war was not only prudent, it also saved lives. And that, my friends, has been what I wanted to tell you about Vulcan for today. What are your thoughts on his early years and integration into the Legion? Let me know and discuss in the comments below. Was this video informative or enjoyable? In that case, please click the like button and subscribe for more content. And if you'd like to keep the lore videos coming, please go check my Patreon page, the link for which is in the video description. Thank you very much for watching, and I wish you all an amazing day. The Emperor protects.